Good morning. Welcome to St. John's. We are glad that you are here this morning for the 11 o'clock service. Let us prepare our hearts and minds as we worship together today.
Thank you.
pray together. The prayer printed in your bulletin. Let us pray. O God, our God and guardian, you have led us apart from the busy world into the quiet of your house. Grant us grace to worship you in spirit and in truth, to the comfort of our souls and the upbuilding of our good purpose and holy desire. Enable us to do more perfectly the work to which you have called us, that we may not fear the coming of night, when we shall resign into your hands the tasks which you have committed to us. So may we worship you not with our lips at this hour, but in word and deed all the days of our lives, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
I'd like to ask Susan McDonald and her husband Terry to come forward. At the first couple of services today, I said, with joy, with gladness, or something like that. And it was so inappropriate. Susan is retiring after being in ministry among us for lo these years, and it's been marvelous. She's been the one who has produced the CBN, the church bulletin and newsletter, who has kept our database, the ACS, automated church system. She has been the whiz. She has been the whiz that's kept us straight, not only with her technical expertise, but with her personality and her peacemaking abilities, her way of sharing love with you all and with all of us on staff. And on your behalf, through your giving, we have a gift for her, and we just want to say thank you. And I would encourage all of you to stand in a standing ovation and say thank you to her. Susan, a chance to say something.
When Harry hired me, he told me that I wouldn't have just one or even two bosses. He told me that I would have hundreds of bosses. Now, that scared me a little bit, but I got to tell you all, I could not have asked for better bosses. It has been my honor and my privilege to serve St. John's and all of you. Thank you so much, and I love you all.
We will miss Susan very much in the office, and I know all of you will as well, coming in to see her. Just a few announcements. I would like you to keep our confirmands in prayer. They are at Lake Junaluska. They'll be heading back this week from their weekend retreat. Next Sunday is Confirmation Sunday, so mark that on your calendar and be here to support them and send them on this new journey as they are confirmed. We also want to be in prayer for Dr. Tim as he goes for his surgery this week, and for Cindy, his wife, and family. we'll be praying for all of them and the doctors involved as well. Thank you to Tom Calhoun for leading our chancel choir this morning. Catherine is actually with the confirmands this weekend on their retreat, so we're just glad that each of you are here today. If you have not done so, please record your presence in the friendship pads. They're the booklets near the center aisle. And welcome those around you. Thank you for being here. stand as you are able as we affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we pray in these quiet moments that we might allow you to fill our hearts, that your Spirit may dwell within us, among us, in us, so that we might know your comfort and your strength that goes beyond our own. Lord, there are members of our community and congregation and family members thereof who are going through difficult times, and we pray, Lord, that you give them strength and grace for every moment of life, for every moment of life. We thank you for the forgiveness that you offer to us. We thank you for the season of Lent, when we take that longer look at ourselves and we ask ourselves whether or not we fully love you, whether or not we're zealous for you or zealous for ourselves, that we are obedient children or not. We're grateful, Lord, for all the ways that you lead us and guide us. We need your direction. Lord, the penultimate question that is upon our hearts and minds every day of every week, but especially on Sundays, is what is your will for me, Lord? What is your will for me? Oh, Lord, help us each to grasp some inkling of that answer today, that by the time we leave this service of worship, we will know more of your will for each of us. Lord, hear our prayers for our neighbors, our country, our world. Hear our prayers for ourselves, that you might break open those barriers that we place between you and us. Please help us, Lord, to take down each brick one by one so that we might find ourselves in full awareness of your presence, so filled with joy that come what may, we can celebrate who you are and worship you in spirit and in truth. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples and has taught us praying. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Amen.
And now I would like to invite the ushers to come forward for our morning tithes and offerings as we give to God as God has given to us.
Thank you.
Remain standing as we sing our hymn of preparation, number 289, and our crew surfer will come and lead our children to Children's Church, which is located in the chapel.
Remain standing for the gospel lesson. John's gospel, the second chapter. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. And he scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" And Jesus answered, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." And they replied, "It's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said, and then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Zeal. It's an interesting word, to have zeal, to have zeal. There was a daughter who asked her dad if she could explain the difference between anger and exasperation, perhaps a form of zeal. The difference between anger and exasperation. And the dad said, "Well, you know, I ride on the bus to work with this grumpy fellow. I mean, he's always in a bad mood. I think I can use him as a way to explain the difference between anger and exasperation. Let's give him a call. I'll put it on speakerphone." And so he dialed the number and asked, "Is Mel there?" And the cranky guy said, "There's no Mel here. You should look up the number properly before you call." And he hung up. He looked at his daughter and he said, he was annoyed. It's not anger. It's not exasperation. He was annoyed. I probably took him from something he wanted to be doing, interrupted him, whatever. He was annoyed. But now let's find out about anger. And so he called the same number and said, "Is Mel there? I just told you Mel wasn't here. What are you, some sort of..." And then, bam, he put the phone down. He said to his daughter, "That was anger. That was anger. Let's wait a few minutes, maybe 5 minutes, and we'll find out about exasperation." So he called back 5 minutes later and asked, "This is Mel. Do you have any messages for me?" Some would use this passage of scripture about Jesus overturning the money changers' tables and getting all the animals kicked out of the temple courts and the court of the Gentiles. They would say that Jesus was beyond anger, that perhaps he was exasperated. Some would even try to use this passage of scripture as a means to say and justify ourselves that we should be angry at times as well. It does say, I will admit, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26, "In your anger do not sin." In your anger do not sin, which presupposes that it is possible for us to be angry and not sin. I'm not so sure that's possible for me, however. I'm not sure if it's possible for you. That's between you and God. But I know about me. I don't have the same kind of zeal that Jesus has. It says, as a quotation from Psalm 65, verse 9, "Zeal for your house will consume me." That Jesus was zealous about the house of the Lord, zealous for God's people and for God. That is part of worship that he offers us to take a view of in this passage, is a type of worship that has such zeal that it almost appears to be overzealous. Overzealous. Oh, we get that way sometimes. But typically, when I get overzealous about something, I offend people. And sometimes I'm easily offended. I'm like the guy in the establishment who asked the owner of the establishment. I'm trying to camouflage this just a bit. I don't tell too many stories about such establishments. But the person there in the establishment said, I'd like two beverages. And the owner of the establishment said, "Well, would you like them one at a time? Would you like them both together?" And he said, "I'd like them both together for me and my friend." And the owner of the establishment looked around. He didn't see anybody. Who was his friend? And he glanced away for a second, and then he looked back, and he saw that the man had pulled out of his pocket a 3-inch human being, a 3-inch man. He put him down on the counter, And the owner of the establishment said, I've never seen anything like this. This is amazing. This is amazing. Can he drink? Oh, the man said, sure he can. And so he said, Bob, drink it down. And Bob drank it all down. And the owner said, I can't imagine. Can he walk? Oh, sure he can. And so he flipped a nickel down the counter, and he said, Bob, skip down there and get that nickel. And little 3-inch Bob went down there, and he got the nickel, and he came back. And the owner was astonished, and he said, this is unbelievable. Can he talk? Can he talk? And the guy who had the 3-inch friend said, oh, sure, he can talk. Bob, tell him the story about how we went hunting in Africa last year, and when you called that witch doctor an idiot. Sometimes when we call people a fool or an idiot or whatever the case may be, we cause ourselves to shrink from our 6-foot frame to a 3-inch frame. We diminish ourselves when we are offended or when we offend someone else. When we call someone this, that, or the other, we don't do much good. Instead of blessing, we blast. Instead of healing, we hurt. Instead of doing what we should do when we're dealing with those who differ from us, we actually try to hurt them, and in doing so, we hurt ourselves more. So what can we learn from this passage of Scripture? How do we learn to deal with those who are difficult to deal with? The difference between Jesus, I think, sometimes, and most of the rest of us, I just say most of the rest of us, is that we have wrong purposes. We, mostly, have wrong purposes in our anger. We mostly have wrong purposes. Jesus' purpose was to cleanse the temple so that proper worship might take place there. The temple compound, 35 acres, the temple itself with the Holy of Holies on one end, and the court of the Gentiles on the other. The court of the Gentiles is where these money changers were located. The court of the Gentiles was a significant part of the temple because it was meant to be the temple. It was meant to be a place to exemplify God's grace for all humankind. Remember the promise of God to Abraham? Abraham, through you all nations will be blessed. So even the temple of God had a court of the Gentiles, and yet these people in charge of the temple wanted to exclude the Gentiles, wanted to exclude people from God's grace. And so they took it over. And there were pilgrims who would come to the Passover. This took place at Passover time. There were those who would come from all across the world, and they would come and they would make sacrifice for the forgiveness of sins. Well, when you make sacrifice to God, you're to bring an unblemished animal. And if you brought your animal from hundreds of miles away or even farther than that, there's no doubt the chance that your animal might be blemished by the time you got to the temple. And so what people would do is they would make plans that when they got to the temple, they would purchase an animal, a dove or sheep or an oxen, so that they might make sacrifice. So instead of bringing the animal, they brought money. They brought money. And so when they brought the money, the people in charge of the temple said, well, you know, the money you brought has Caesar's description on it. It has Caesar's face upon it. We can't accept that. You know, we have these commandments that say you can't make a graven image. You don't make an idol out of something or someone. So we've got to exchange your money. And we hate to do it, but we have to do it. We have to charge you a little bit more than the going rate. And so they had to exchange their money. So these people there with all these animals to sell to these pilgrims who were coming, and these money changers there with their less than cut rates for money exchange, were all there as a way to exclude people from the kingdom of God. So Jesus' purpose was to set people right, that this place, a place of worship, is to be a place of worship so that God might be honored and so that people might have inclusive access to God's grace. That for so God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, and no one is left out of that love. No one is left out of that love. So Jesus had a good purpose. Do we have a good purpose when we get upset? When our zeal overflows and we get bent out of shape about something? Or do we diminish ourselves and we call people idiots and whatever the case may be? Indeed, these people had turned the temple into something about like the New York Stock Exchange on a sell day. And it was a seller's market at the temple. Is our purpose to honor God and to help people? Well, the proof that's in the pudding, and when we deal with anger, when we deal with our exasperation, when we question whether or not we truly have zeal for the Lord rather than zeal for ourselves, is the process by which we correct others. The process. Zeal turns into exasperation, into rage sometimes. We heard recently, just in the last week or so, about Chevy Chase, one of my favorite comedians, who had road rage of all things. You know, you would think Chevy Chase would be able to laugh it off, but sometimes all of us have road rage or some other kind of rage. We're a lot like the farmer who was out in his cornfield one day, and he saw a little mouse, who in a whole season of harvest, in a whole season, probably wouldn't even be able to eat 3 stalks of corn, but this mouse was eating this corn. And the farmer thought to himself, you know, I spent my good, hard time. I spent my labor in clearing this field. I spent my labor in planting this seed. I spent my labor in cultivating the soil. And here is this mouse. And so he finds a stick and he starts whack, whack, whacking, trying to kill that mouse. And he goes on a tirade, just an all-out rage. And then he looks up when he realizes he can't find the mouse and he sees that he is whacked down an acre of corn. Our process sometimes when we're trying to stand up for what is right, when we're trying to stand up even for God or even for other people, is that we find that we do more damage than we do good. We do more damage than we do good. Sometimes we're misdirected in our anger. I've seen couples, for instance, who get mad at one another. And I've seen some couples who just seem to always like having something to get mad at one another about. I thought I told you. But who are the victims? The children? Or the neighbors? Or the first responders who come into that domestic violence situation, which should never have happened? And as this man and woman are after each other, it's the first responder who gets shot. It's awful. It's awful. Sometimes our anger is misdirected and we cause more problems than good. We're a lot like the knight who came back to report to the king what he had been doing on the king's behalf. And the knight was proud of himself. And the knight said to the king, "Well, I've been looting and pillaging and burning your enemies to the west." And the king said, "Well, I don't have any enemies to the west." And the knight said, "You do now." Misdirected anger. It does more harm than good. And usually it does more harm to others than it does to ourselves. We need to follow Jesus' example. We need to think before we act. We need to think before we act. He had good reason. Good reason presupposes reasoning. Do we do reasoning before we blast others in our so-called righteous indignation? Do we ponder the repercussions, the implications of our zeal? I believe Jesus did. He clearly showed that he thought before he acted, because it says in verse 15, "So he made a whip out of cords and drove all of them from the temple courts." He made a whip of cords. That strikes me as being premeditation. He thought through this, that he wanted to make sure that God's people truly worship the Lord and He wanted to make sure that these Gentiles, the court of the Gentiles, was not overrun by these money changers and these religious extortionists. He thought it through. Now me, when I'm dealing with some of the things that bother me, I tend to blurt out my anger. I tend to blow up. There's a mushroom cloud. It just happens like that. I mean, none of us, I think, get up early in the morning and write out our to-do list and put down number 4. At noon, I will be angry for 15 minutes, and then I'll have a great afternoon. That's not how it works, is it? Now, we might plan ahead that we need to have a difficult discussion with someone. We might plan ahead that we might need to have some sort of careful confrontation. But we need to plan ahead as Jesus did. If Jesus needed to plan ahead to make a whip, of course, to deal with those who were dishonoring God and dishonoring people made in God's image, then we really need to plan ahead. And we need to think about what we're doing rather than flying off the handle. Will Rogers, great person of wit and comedy and wisdom from years ago, said, "Those who fly off in a rage always have a bad landing." So we need to think about things. We need to think, will this help or will this hurt? Will this bless or will this blast? Will this do more good to others? Or is this something just to make me feel better about things? So we need to think. I don't know if you've heard the story of the reporter who went to the mountains, and he was in a backwoods valley, and there were a number of politicians there, everyone giving their speech, and everybody who was listening was hooping and hollering. I mean, it was hooping and hollering, hooping and hollering. And finally, the reporter went over to one of the loudest persons there and said, "What do you think about all these campaign promises?" And the man who had been the most vocal of the shouters and the hoopers and the hollerers said, "I didn't come here to think. I came here to holler." Gosh, that looks like me in the mirror sometimes. I didn't come here to think. I came here to holler. You know, there are certain people that are like that and stay like that. They just want to holler. They just going to have something going. They want to be mean and raise up a ruckus, and they bring more harm than good. They're like the lady who went to the doctor. She had not gone to the doctor in time to save her life. She had been bitten by a rabid raccoon and thought, well, it was just a scratch and the raccoon was fine and everything was okay. And she just said, well, I'll just get over it and I'll get over it. And well, she didn't get over it. And so she went to the doctor, and the doctor said, "I'm sorry, ma'am, but it seems that you're too late for us to save your life. You need to make your final preparations to be ready to meet your maker." And she said, "Well, sir, can I have a piece of paper and a pen?" And he thought, well, she's going to be making out her will. And so he gave her the pen and paper. He looked aside, you know, washed his hands or something, turned back to her and said, "Well, is your will completed?" She said, "What will?" I said, "I thought you were writing a will." She said, "No, I'm writing a list of all the people I want to bite." Well, I don't think she was quite ready to meet her maker, and I'm not sure if we'll be quite ready for Easter if we don't have a good enough Lent so that we might understand that sometimes we need to refrain from anger. We need to be careful that if we are to be people of zeal, it needs to be zeal for the Lord, not zeal for Tim or zeal for whomever, whatever your name is. Our zeal needs to be for the Lord. We need to be like nitroglycerin. You ever thought about nitroglycerin? Nitroglycerin in a liquid state is very unstable. I mean, it's, you know, scary. It'll blow up in a heartbeat, just like that. But then on the other hand, nitroglycerin can be made into a paste and can be formed into dynamite. But even then, it's dangerous, explosive. Nitroglycerin is not a very good thing. except when it is in small, controlled amounts, it can save the heart of someone about to have a heart attack. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we were like that? That in our interactions with other people, we might give more grace, that we might be more forgiving, that we might, in small, controlled amounts, help them in their road to discipleship without pointing a finger so much at their issue as looking back at ourselves and saying, God, help me, sinner that I am. Jesus gives us a wonderful example in this passage of Scripture of what our purpose should be in dealing with those feelings that rise within us that wants to bring others down. And he shows us a process, a reasonable thinking process, that allows us to offer grace when we make room for God's inclusion of all people. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, help us to think before we act. Help us to commit ourselves to bless more than blast. Help us to be persons who heal more than hurt. Please forgive us for the ways that we've damaged others and we've caused ourselves to shrink before the face of difficulty. Help us, Lord Jesus, to have proper purposes that we're willing to honor you and love others. To fulfill the two greatest commandments, to love you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. This is our prayer through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our hymn is number 427. I invite you to stand as you're able. now may the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the comfort and courage of the Holy Spirit be yours both now and forevermore. Amen.